YouTube friends, how's it going? I'm going to start off the medicinal herb series that I've been so excited about. Went to a company called Richter's, and here's one of the seed packets here. Richter's out of Ontario. I was absolutely stunned and amazed at how many different herbal selections that they had, medicinal herbs. It was absolutely stunning. Their little catalog took me days to pour through and read through each one to see if it's something that was going to work for me and my family. Basically, what I'm looking for, we're in growing zone 3B, so we have barely 100 growing days a year, and I'm looking for something that, number one, first and foremost, comes back every single year. I don't have to replant it again like lettuce or tomatoes or, you know, most of the veg that we all deal with. So these were medicinal herbs, you know, that I kind of poured through and took a look at our personal situation and the types of different challenges that we're going through. I've got a couple of daughters, have a beautiful wife, and, you know, obviously they're all at different stages of life. We've got some heavy menstruation, we've got some non-existent menstruation, we have menopause coming on. I mean, just as a family, there's some insomnia, there's a bit of anxiety, there's certainly a bit of the blues every now and again, a little depression. There's common colds, I have asthma, so anything bronchial related was something that I was very, very interested in. So it has to be something that's going to help our family. It certainly has to come back in our type of a climate. And I went through and picked out probably about 40 different herbs that I want to get growing. So we want to take a look at what the seeds look like, how to plant them, what the germination rate is like, how do they come up. Let's get them in the ground, and then let's chart the growth over the course of the year just to see how they work. At the end of the year, we're going to do a bunch of drying. We're going to grab some roots. We're going to just get a little bit more involved. Now, I should have prefaced this. I'm not a herbologist. I'm not a herbalist. My name's not even Herb. Okay, I'm learning just like most other people are, and I feel like the best way to learn is just to get involved and, you know, a couple of bucks for some seeds, you know, to grow it, to see how it works. I mean, I can't really poo-poo something if I haven't tried it. So I'm excited about this. I'm going to try to keep these fairly short. I don't want to ramble on. Again, I'm not a herbalist, so I'm not going to be able to give you every technical term of what this does and what that does. But we're going to go through some of the traditional uses, you know, how they were used, what they're used for, what they're supposed to help alleviate. And we'll see if we can take it from there. Now, most of these seed packets, I would imagine, are going to have quite a few seeds in them. I'm planting in 6-cell trays, and I'm going to do one packet per 6. So there should be plenty of seeds left over. If there is anyone that is interested in using some of these seeds, they want to give it a try, 100%. I'm not going to need them after this because, again, one of the main keys is they're perennials and they come back. They're cold hardy. So if there is anybody that's interested, please leave it in the comment section below. Give me a personal message. And, you know, for the people that are in and around this area, more than welcome to swing by and I'll hook you up with some seeds. If you're, pardon me, from far away or, you know, even farther away overseas, it's only a buck or so to pop stuff in the mail. And again, I have absolutely no problems sharing because I'm not going to use the rest of them. Once I get them established, you can either collect seeds to plant more, stem cuttings, root propagation. There's tons of different ways to make more than one plant out of a plant. So let's get started and see what this stuff looks like. All right, guys. First one we're going to take a look at, I hope that's in the screen, is Coastal Mugwort. My Latin is very, very rusty. It's been a long time since I lived in Latin. And you know how you lose stuff when you get older, right? But I will try to pop it up on the screen there, the Latin name. Coastal Mugwort. I'm just checking my notes here. It grows coastally in the areas from Northern California all the way down to Southern British Columbia in Canada and the U.S. It's got a very large, silvery, kind of hairy-type leaf. And I will also try to pop a picture up on this video just to see so that you guys can see what. Holy cow! I don't even know if that'll show up on the screen. Those are absolutely tiny. Wow, interesting. Anyway, according to my notes here, this is more of a yin-like, and burning the moxa made with this mugwort. Moxa is sort of a dry rolled herbal product that you light on fire and inhale the fumes to achieve the medicinal properties of it. And it's very, very common in Asian medicine. I can't just say Chinese because I'm pretty sure all the other countries have doctors as well. But that should be plenty. Wow, there's going to be quite a few of these left that I won't need. But burning this and breathing it in, from what they're saying here, soothes the nerves and induces a truly remarkable experience of surrender and the tearing down of walls of the heart. Gives immediate relief for insomnia, anxiety, headache, and muscle tension. Grows about 18 to 36 inches high, which is nice, and a very slight infusion is excellent for all disorders of the stomach, prevents sickness after meals, and creates an appetite, and helps cleanse the liver. Ho ho! Liver cleansing! Who couldn't use a little bit of that? All right, get excited. Where's my little labels that I made up? Hold on a sec. Here we go. Should have been more prepared. Definitely want to make sure that we pop the labels in because I'm not going to have a clue what they were afterwards if I don't. So there is the first one. Now, the second one here is called Chinese Senega. This one's kind of interesting to me for a few reasons. Let's see my notes here. Perennial herb, about a foot high, grows throughout Central and Western North America. In the woods or on dry, rocky soil, the leaves are small and alternate, narrowly lanceolate. So they're very, very thin leaves that alternate on the sides of the stem. Numerous small pink-white flowers are crowded on a narrow terminal spike about an inch to 2 inches long. The Latin name, Polygala, means much milk, alluding to its profuse secretions and their effects. Senega is derived from the Seneca tribe of the North American Indians, who used this as a remedy for snake bites, earaches, amongst other things. So let's take a boo at this. Now, from what I've read, apparently the Chinese version grows a little, it's a little hardier. Oh, those aren't bad. Those are fairly easy to see. We'll pop, oh man, there's tons in there. Oh, get excited. I guess I'll be giving lots of these away. All right. So, Chinese medicine, it calms the spirit and opens the flow of qi in the heart, which in Western terms may be related to its sedative and tranquilizing properties. It's used for anxiety, insomnia, palpitations, poor memory, and depression, especially in cases of excessive brooding or pent-up emotions. Why didn't they just write my name on that? We'll put a couple in each one here. I don't know. I'm very highly interested in anything that is native, you know, to the area or similar type plants, and especially things that, you know, cultures before ours used consistently to solve their own health issues. You know, it hasn't really been all that long that we've had, you know, pharmacies and that type of thing. So, you know, if this stuff worked, you know, for hundreds of years, then it can work for me. Zone 2. So this can literally grow in darn near the Arctic. So I wrote a few notes on here. You know, whenever, 10 inches high, plant 8 to 20 inches apart. So there we go. We got tons of that to give away. Holy cow. That's nice. All right. Chinese Senega. All right. What's our next one here? This one I'm very, very excited about. Done a bunch of reading on this. It's called Roseroot. Rhodiola rosea is the old Latin term. I guess there really is no new Latin terms, is there? All right, so this is an adaptogenic like ginseng, and an adaptogen, like a lot of these traditional or herbal medicines will focus on one area. It's a liver cleanser, or it's a blood cleanser, or it's a bronchial. So they'll focus on one area of the body. Adaptogens adapt to what your need is. So it's not just one thing. Oh my goodness, these things are tiny. Can we even see those? And there is a boatload of them in here. My goodness. All right. Well, I'm just going to tap them into here real quick. And obviously, I'm going to have to do some thinning out of these. But Roseroot is actually, I believe, from the Siberian area of everyone's friend, Russia. And it's been studied for years and years by the Russian government. Studied decades ago, Roseroot is only the second North American herb after ginseng to be recognized as an adaptogen, a herb with the ability to restore the body and mind after physical and mental exertion and stress. The rose-scented roots contain unique compounds that are thought to account for the adaptogenic properties. Research also shows that the roots improve learning and memory and act as a tonic. In folkloric medicine, the leaves were used as aloe to treat cuts and burns, and the Eskimos, which, you know, in all honesty, I mean, like, I believe they call themselves Inuits, not Eskimos. So the Inuit used it as a decoction of the flowers for stomach and intestinal discomfort. The flowers are a yellow with reddish and purple tones, and this is a very low growing plant, so it's anywhere from like 2 inches to 16 inches high. This is something that I've read an awful lot about, and it's something that's very, very interesting to me. So I am excited about that one. Where's my little rose root? There we go. There we go. Let's pop that in there. Moving on. This one's fairly popular in North America. I've seen a few YouTubers that have gardens with this in it. It's called Elecampane. Elecampane. It's a skyscraper, though. It can grow anywhere from 7 to 10 feet high. Very hardy perennial. Makes an impression in the garden. Let's see here. Topped with dark yellow flowers throughout the summer. In fact, I believe this is part of the sunflower family. Since before Roman times, Elecampane has been used for medicine, mainly for its expectorant qualities. In the Middle Ages, it was sold as a candied root, as a soothing lozenge for asthma and indigestion. Today, the dried root preparations are used to quiet coughing, stimulate digestion, and to soothe the stomach. And back in the day, they used to use the flowers to make yellow dyes. So let's see what these look like. Those are a fair bit bigger. That's something that's a little easier to handle. Elecampane. It's going to be kind of neat having something that big growing out in the yard. It'll make my trees want to grow bigger, because everything's competitive in nature, right? All right, let's pop these in. And I'm going to put a little bit of soil on top of all of these when I'm done so that they're covered. And I pre-soaked this soil, so I'll just give it a little mist of water afterwards when we're done. But my goodness, you know, for a couple of bucks, you can't really see in there, but there's thousands of seeds. I'm going to have so many of these to give away because I really shouldn't need them anymore. This is a really nice looking plant. Again, like I say, it's has the image of a sunflower. So the next ones here, both of these, we'll do these really quick together. Black Hollyhock and Hollyhock, the sort of original version of it. From everything that I've read about these, they're vigorously self-sowing, so even if they aren't necessarily sort of a perennial, they will drop. Look at the size of these bad boys. Woohoo! These will drop seeds, and once you get Hollyhock established, you will have these beautiful flowers. You'll have them forever. They will keep coming back. If you take a look at any images on Google, or if you look at any of the Hollyhock growing videos, they are they're an absolutely beautiful plant. The flowers of them are edible. The young shoots are edible. You can actually cut them and peel them and then eat them like an asparagus. I'm going to put a couple in each here just to just to make sure that we've got some decent germination. And where is my... Where's my... Oh, there's my other hollyhock. When you put the flowers into a tea, they're used for preventing and treating breathing disorders and digestive problems. So again, sort of follows with the whole asthma theme that I was going with. And again, there are tons and tons of these. If anyone's interested in these, please let me know. They grow 4 to 8 feet high. I space them about 12 to 36 inches apart. I'll be doing more of the 12 variety simply because I like to plant things fairly close. I'm not a huge fan of open dead spaces. I much, much prefer more of a forest or a jungle look. Feels more natural to me. These are huge seeds. I watched a video on collecting these, and it is easy peasy. Like once they set out their seed pods, you plant one of these, you will have hollyhock to give away for the rest of your natural born life. Okay, so where are we here? Hollyhock and black hollyhock. The black hollyhock ones, apparently, when you put those flowers in a tea, they really color the water and give it a nice look. This one here, I'm going to butcher. My Mandarin is absolutely horrible. In fact, my knowledge is pretty bad. I don't even know if this is Mandarin or Cantonese, but Zhi Mu. Let's pull up our notes on this. Okay, this is more of like, it looks like a grass. And again, I'm going to attempt to splice pictures in here. Chinese medicinal herb that looks and grows like a tall grass, but isn't. It spreads by undergrown rhizomes or roots, like grasses, but unlike grasses, it has a fragrant yellow-white or light purple flowers that open in the evening, late summer and autumn. It's been used in China for over 2,000 years. The rhizomes are noted for their anti-diabetic and antibacterial properties and are used for pneumonia, bronchitis, high fever, irritability, and insomnia. Oh, wow. Well, there's not a whole lot in this pack. That's for darn sure. So we'll put one in each. Let's see what's going on. And I'll pop the rest back into the pack. And if anybody's looking for a plant to grow that they don't know how to pronounce, I can help you out. I think with something like this, if it spreads by rhizomes, I'll probably put this in a container out in the yard just so that I don't have it going everywhere until I get a little more familiar with how the plant reacts and responds. Ba-doop. Okay, Maral root. All right, so this grows 30 to 60 inches. This grows all over the place. It's got some really nice pink flower heads on it. This has been studied by Russian scientists, used in the Russian athletic training program for decades. This is also an adaptogen, so it helps athletes increase endurance, reflexes on concentration, and helps them to recover faster from exertion. Studies show that the root extract greatly increases the work capacity of muscles and normalizes blood sugar levels quickly after exertion and improves the memory and learning. So this... those are great. I don't have anything against small seeds besides I have bad eyes and, you know, big fingers. So, here we go. Let's pop a few of these in here. Anything that's an adaptogen I tend to like, you know. I don't know. I guess it's sort of more of a broad spectrum, you know. If you've got a little weakness here or there, I feel like it's something that could potentially help a person out. Let's get you guys back in there. And, oh my, there's tons of the Maral root left. Is there anything else here? Violet flowers appear in the second year, reaching up to 5 feet high. Grows in deep, well-drained, fertile soil in full sun. Very hardy. Seeds are said to respond to outdoor exposure. But this company says that they don't have any problems germinating them in flats without cold. So... we will give the Maral root a try. Scullcap. Scullcap's another sort of low-growing plant, so that would go more on my south exposure of, say, one of my fruit trees and some of the taller stuff like a hollyhock, would go on the back side of it. So skull cap. Yeah, it looks almost like kind of a nice little ground cover. Effective and reliable remedy for headaches and neuralgia. Good sedative for insomnia, restlessness, hysteria, and convulsions. These sound small. Oh yeah, they're tiny. Okay, I don't even know if you can see those. Let's put some in there. Here. Okay, there, we're getting some out now. Easy, settle down, Ryan, settle down. There we go. Okay, there is hundreds left in there to share. Okay, moving on. Lovage. Love the Lovage. Leaves possess excellent flavor and qualities for soups, stews, and casseroles. Flavor is reminiscent of celery. And of the famous yeast extract, magi. Can replace meat and bone stock in soups and also gives character to vegetables, meats, and fish dishes. Huh. Very interesting. Very, very interesting. Let's see what these guys look like. They sound bigger. Oh, yeah, they're bigger. And there's tons. My lord. Okay, that's plenty. That is plenty. Oh, I didn't put my little tab in the other one. Remember to mark these, or because this is my first time growing almost every single one of these. It, you know, it's different when you forget to put a label in on, you know, where you plant your radishes or tomatoes. It's pretty easy to tell what those things look like, right? But when these come up, I'm not going to have a sniff other than if I name them. So, Lovage. Okay, this was Skullcap. And there's Lovage right there. Okay, two more, and we're done on this batch, guys. Okay, Primadonna. Deep red, deep rose, Echinacea. I think most people have heard of Echinacea. They've seen them in the stores, or they've taken supplements or what have you. So I don't know that I need to expound upon the virtues of Echinacea, other than the fact that I would greatly like to have it growing in my yard. Extremely heat and cold tolerant, and those are some decent seeds again. That's something that person can get their hands on. You know, I don't need magnifying glasses like I do when I'm reading a seed packet. So I'll pop a few of these in here. Really nice, deep red color on the flowers from what I've seen. What do my notes say? 2 to 3 feet high, so nothing too crazy. Probably make a half decent little kind of border plant. There we go. Where are we? Primadonna. Go. And then the last one here, the reason why I looked this one up and kind of settled on it is a friend of mine's mother is dealing with MS right now. Well, I guess not just right now, but and this is black-eyed Susans. These are fairly common in our neck of the woods here in Alberta. They do grow, well, once they're established, they pretty much grow wild. The big thing with these is the root. Dried root and then made into a decoction, sort of, you know, boiled in water for a little while, is said to be more effective than Echinacea when it comes to relieving symptoms of MS. So this was one of the plants that I wanted to, oh man, they're tiny. They're itty bitty again. So I'm gonna pop some of these in here. Come on now, work with me, not against me. And again, I have no problems giving a bunch of this away because, you know, the way that I'm looking at it is I really shouldn't have to plant these again. So long as I can, oh, there's thousands in there. As soon as I can get these settled and set and growing in the garden, every single one of these I'm not going to have much of a use for. But the black-eyed Susans, one of the most beloved wildflowers, gold-orange daisies, brown centers appear from July through to September. Both the root and the leaves have been used by North American native tribes to treat a wide range of ailments, from worms in children to snake bites and ear bites. So There is a quick little look. Again, I'm going to put a little bit of soil over top of these, mist it down with some water, and we're going to keep track of them. We're going to see how they go. I've got about, well, I don't know, optimistically about 6 weeks, but probably about 7 weeks until our last frost date rolls around. I would prefer to get these established without frost, get the root system going in the ground, and then they should be absolutely fine. So if there's something in there that you saw that you're interested in, please let me know. If you have some really in-depth questions, please Google it, okay? I'm not a herbalist. I didn't go to school for this. I'm very interested in it. I want to grow it in my yard. I would like to use it, and we'll see how it goes. I've got probably another 2 or 3 series on this. Thanks for checking this out. Give it a thumbs up if you like. Share it with friends. If you like these kind of weird gardening things, subscribe to my channel. And other than that, have a fantastic day. We'll see you on the next one.